Years ago, an article Margaret Mead, the anthropologist, had written about hugging your child and giving them body comfort.
Right.
And you thought, many of these people needed that body comfort, even as kids.
Yeah, it's, I think in all of this, I mean, there's Chris Jeromo, who's a wonderful screenwriter in Hollywood, is in the book, and he wrote Mississippi Burning, and we went to school together when we were young, and he's atheistic. I mean, he doesn't really believe in God, you know, there's not, and his whole A Moment of Clarity came through the people that he met in recovery. Yeah. And this idea of connecting to other human beings, whether it's physically or emotionally. I mean, this idea that you can actually, that is what, I mean, Tom Arnold said the same thing. I mean, when Tom came home, his moment of clarity was he came home one night after, you know, a night of debauchery, and ended up at his house where he was living with Roseanne, and he had to punch in his code for the door, and he'd forgotten what the code was. It was his birthday. And so he had to call Roseanne up, and it was 6 o'clock in the morning, and he knew she was going to come down and be furious at him. And he watched her come down the hill, and he describes the scene perfectly. And she gets there, and he's thinking, oh, she's going to get mad, she's going to hit me, she's going to... And she just opened the gate, and she put her arms around him and said, I just want you to come home. And it was in that moment of this unconditional love that he felt that everything vanished. I mean, and how does that happen?
Yeah.
I mean, that's interesting thing.
And Jamie Lee Curtis, Vicodin was her drug of choice.
Right. I mean, I think, and again, with her, as with many of these folks, they had a personality that people saw that they never saw behind what was going on behind.
And so, they live with secrets, because there are certain drugs you can take and no one will ever know except you.
Right.
And drinking is obvious, you know, that shows. Putting on weight, that's an obvious, people can see. But there are quiet drugs that some of the people took that they lived with that secret and the desperation to find a doctor who would write the prescription.
Right, and it's this idea of what you, I mean, the torment and the pain of that. I mean, and you know, to have to endure that daily and to feel that way and to have that removed from your life. I mean, Jamie, I've known my whole life, and when I listened to her, I cried when I heard her thing. Because the power of her transformation in terms of what this means in her life, her recovery is.
And there is one of the first ones, your cousin Patrick, who already has been elected, has had his own problems, and maybe that's the worst part, to be a politician and have to face your demons in the public.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, Patrick's moment, you know, was played out in front of the world press in the United States Capitol. So that was a powerful, difficult thing for him. But he, you know, the wonderful thing about him, and he did the foreword to Moments of Clarity, is that he's, you know, committed through his experience. His public life is about, you know, making life better for the people in this country that suffer from this thing. He, you know, he was a co-sponsor of the parity bill with Jim Ramstead and has done that. And all the people in this book, the reason they're in this book is because they have a commitment to help the people out there who may not have any hope.
Tell me how you started the book, because who was the first one and how did you get the idea that people would open up to you?
Well, I didn't know. I really didn't know. I was working with an agent in New York, and I was involved in writing a novel. I was writing a novel about a guy trying to figure women out and having a difficult time of it. And she said to me, you know, can't you do something more about recovery? And I kept getting emails from people from all over the country going, you should write about a book about the family, you should write a book about this. And there was such a need. So I started to at least think about it. And she had this idea. She had read a book by Marlo Thomas called The Right Words.
Uh-huh.
Remember that book?
Yes.
It was a wonderful book that Marlo did of all celebrities talking about the words somebody said to them at a point in their life that changed their life.
Yeah.
So she said, isn't there something around recovery? And I started to think about this moment of clarity, this thing that happened, because people were asking me about that out there. And so that seemed to be it. I had no idea whether I could get anybody to do this with me. So I sent out 4 letters to people I knew. Some of them were famous, some of them weren't. And I, one guy, a movie star who I thought would say yes right away, said no. One movie star I didn't know at all said yes, and two other people I never heard from. So I was sort of 50-50, and I thought, this is going to be difficult.
Yeah.
And I just kept kind of like And then a friend of mine said to me, he goes, you know what? If this book is meant to be, it will happen. And the people that are meant to be in it will be in it. And so I just, that's what I did. And it, people just kept showing up and it happened. And the woman who bought it at HarperCollins moved on to another job. And I got another editor who was wonderful. And it just happened. It wasn't because I made it happen or anything else, it just was meant to
be. Is that, in a way, if it's meant to be, an end result of moments of clarity?
I think it is.
Yeah.
I think truthfully, if this book wasn't meant to be, it wouldn't have happened. I didn't really want to do it. I wasn't that committed. I want to be helpful in the world, but if it's a difficult book to do. It's difficult to ask people for this. There's all the anonymity issues. There's a lot of stuff that I didn't really want to get into, and I was interested in a novel. So this book was clearly meant to be. There's some good behind it, and I'm glad it's here.
How much time would you spend with each person?
I would say about an hour.
That's it?
Yeah. I asked him about 15 questions.
Yeah.
And from that, and some people like Steve Earle talked forever. He's just so brilliant and so smart and so... And then there are other people that were in and out, in 40 minutes.
But Richard Lewis, you must have spent more time with.
Yeah, we spent, I've known Richard forever, and we did a movie together a long time ago called Drunks, and we actually sat at the Four Seasons in Beverly Hills where he had created a lot of havoc in the past.
So, okay, you got it the fourth season. What did you drink?
I think he drank Coke and I drank Perrier.
Yeah. I mean, because that suddenly, it's like giving up smoking. When you give it up, what are you going to do with those two fingers? How do you sit in a bar and just say, Diet Coke, please?
Oh, it's so easy. People go all the time, isn't it difficult for you, isn't it? And the great thing about having a moment of clarity is, as I said before, it becomes effortless. I mean, I don't take it for granted. For a moment.
Yeah.
But I don't struggle at all. It's like something has come into my life that has made this part of my life relatively easy.
I'll tell you, Christopher, I almost feel talking with you. There's like a bright light coming down. I enjoyed reading it. I empathized with the people, and I thank you very much. I think it's an important book. Will you autograph
Absolutely.
It for me?
Thank you so much, Connie.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, email me at talksbooks@lycos.com or www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Courier, see some of the shows, and see some of them being streamed at that moment. Meanwhile, support your local library. Libraries are our finest democratic institution. You can take anyone there if they have a problem reading. Libraries will help them learn to read better. And in some ways, libraries are like art museums, just because they're there, and also because there are so many art books there. I know you've talked at libraries about your books.
Yeah, I do. Whenever I can, I go. I love libraries, and I think, and people still go. I mean, it's still a place that, I mean, the internet obviously is probably cut into a little bit of that, but a library is a wonderful place. I mean, there are people there, and it's a great place to meet folks and talk, and it's great.
It's called Better Than Mr. Goodbar is Mr. Good Book. So we'll see you next time.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
It's great to be here.
We're clear.
Thank you. Thank you.